Okay, great. Welcome back to this next session in the afternoon. My name is Chris Kempis. I'm a professor at the Santa Fe Institute, and it's my pleasure to introduce this fantastic set of panelists for this afternoon. And I'll go just alphabetically through each of them and then hand it over to Caitlin to run the panel. So beginning with Caitlin, SFI's own Caitlin McShay is the modern embodiment of a Renaissance person. She is the Santa Fe Institute's Director of Experimental Programs, where it's hard to think of a better or cooler title. This includes being the director of the InterPlanetary Project and this very festival. Before coming to SFI, she studied philosophy and biology as an undergraduate and has a master's degree from St. John's College. She is an illustrator, editor, creator, and host of the Alien Crash Site podcast, which I highly recommend. The co-author of the multidimensional blog Atlantis, which I also recommend, and a fantastic chef. See what I mean by Renaissance person? Next, we have Dario Robleto, who is simply put one of my favorite artists. His work is too brilliant and too multifaceted to describe without seeing it, bringing together the deepest meanings of natural forms, human myths, scientific knowledge, and the great scales of time and space. To see his work induces an almost transcendental experience, which I had the pleasure of doing here at Site Santa Fe a few years ago. Dario has won numerous awards, including the Rasmussen Fellowship and Alfred P. Sloan Foundation Grant, and has been the artist in residence at institutions ranging from the Smithsonian Museum of Natural History to the SETI Institute. He was also the artist consultant to the Breakthrough Messages, which I'm sure we'll hear more about today. Next, we have Caleb Scharf. Caleb is a professor at Columbia University, where he is the director of the multidisciplinary Columbia Astrobiology Center. Caleb is a theoretical physicist and an astronomer, and one of my favorite thinkers in astrobiology. He is the rare combination of someone who continues to publish in several highly technical disciplines simultaneously. His work focuses on galaxy-scale astronomy, climatic cycles on Earth, and the general principles of life in the universe. On this last subject, he recently published the book, The Ascent of Information, which is a must-read for anyone in the biosciences and anyone in society trying to understand what life is and how we arrived at our current information age. Caleb has written a number of wonderful books and numerous popular scientific articles, and he is recently the recipient of the Carl Sagan Medal for Science Communication from the American Astronomical Society. And last, but certainly not least, is Sarah Walker, who's a professor at the Arizona State University, where she holds many appointments, and where she is the associate director of the ASU-SFI Center for Biosocial Complexity, and where she is the deputy director of the Beyond Center for Fundamental Concepts. She's also an external faculty member here at the Santa Fe Institute, and her work touches on an amazing breadth of topics in origins of life, astrobiology, artificial life, and synthetic biology. And to me, she is a leading light in all of these fields. She brings new physical and mathematical theory to bear on everything from algorithmic principles of life to what metabolism we should look for on Saturn's icy moon Enceladus to quantifying the amount of construction it took to create an object in the hopes of separating life from non-life. All of these diverse topics share a common goal of finding the universal laws of life. And her work has been widely recognized as she recently won the Stanley L. Miller Early Career Award from the International Society of the Study of Origins of Life. So with that fairly lengthy introduction, it's an illustrious panel, I'll hand it over to our only Caitlin McShay. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris. That was wonderful. So you got a lot of background on us. I was going to give us some time to introduce ourselves. Maybe I'll just ask us to kind of reframe what we think is the intersection between objects, life, and our work. In addition to my background in philosophy and biology, I also worked in the arts before I came to SFI, and so I've been thinking about what art is a lot more in my life than I've been thinking about what life is, though neither is easy to define. And yet lately I've become obsessed with objects by virtue of my obsession with astrobiology and, you know, life detection. And so the reason I wanted to frame the conversation around objects is because all of the work that we're doing out in the universal ether, like out on the Martian regolith and elsewhere, insists upon or like assumes that we are in fact capable of discerning between objects made by life and objects that aren't. And of course, I expect that we each have ways to discuss how it is that our work points to that, or how it is that we're actually succeeding in doing it today. But when I think of an object, just by virtue of my philosophy art background, I usually do kind of imagine a human-made artifact, whether it's Las Meninas or Terminator 2, something very highly complex and informationally rich, deeply encoded, an expression that is observable and interpretable. And lately I've come to wonder how many of those attributes I place on art might also exist all the way down across all objects produced by life. So that's sort of what I'm hoping to touch upon today. And with that, I kind of wanted to ask each of you if you could more specifically regale the audience in how your work touches upon this question of objects for life. And I want to start with Caleb. You're right next to me. But I should say that Caleb is returning to Interplanetary. He was here in 2018 for our inaugural event. And he and Chris Kempes actually gave a really lovely elucidation of how it is that we're examining exoplanets, how we might find potentially hospitable exoplanets, et cetera. But since then, you've just published this fantastic book that also seems to kind of operate at this more anthropomorphic scale. And so I wondered how you could speak a little bit about this informational framework that you've been occupying lately as a component of, or as you claim to be, life itself, if you could kind of persuade me.
I have to persuade you? That's going to be difficult. So maybe I can just talk about the central idea in that book, because it's something I've spent a lot of time thinking about, and I suspect we'll have things to discuss on it. So I've given it a term. I call it the data ohm. And for me, the data ohm is, well, at least initially, very focused on what's happening here on the Earth. The data ohm is the sum total of all of our externalized information, so specifically thinking about the human species. And I came to this by just sort of realizing, or, you know, I was naive, I hadn't really thought about this before. I sat there thinking, it's so interesting. We have all this heritable information in our DNA that we sort of, with little effort, give to the next generation, and it propagates through time. But there's all this information that we carry around with us as a species that is not encoded in our DNA, yet it's incredibly persistent. It's also incredibly demanding. It's also incredibly beneficial and has been to us. So it is in all of our books, our bits, our structures. The chairs in this room, I would consider part of the data ohm, because they are, to me, informational objects. There's information encoded in the structure in these objects at many, many different levels. And so, as an astrobiologist, this was intriguing to me, because in astrobiology, we're always trying to understand how we might see the signs of life out in the universe, but also the trajectory that life may take. And so we're looking for sort of fundamental principles. And I'm sure we'll hear more about that from Sarah as well. And to me, something like the externalization of information and the fact that it carries with us through time is sort of an intriguing thing to follow, intriguing thread to follow. And as I got deeper into what it means and looking at things, for example, the burden of our informational world, and that can sound quite trivial and frivolous. Well, yeah, you know, oh, I'm constantly checking my email, right? I better post something on Twitter because I haven't done so in the last 2 minutes. You know, I've got to plug my device in because it needs energy, it needs power. And when you begin to look at the totality of the burden of certainly our modern informational world, but even things like printed books, a substantial proportion of the energy transduction that takes place on this planet for humans goes into information. Okay? And our data servers are enormous energy hogs. Even though they've become increasingly efficient, the rate of growth of our need for them has grown exponentially faster. And so we can perhaps come back to this. I don't want to talk for too much longer, but one idea with the data ohm is that when you begin to examine it in all its facets from many different directions, and especially in the context of evolution, it begins to look like an alternate living system here on Earth. It has emerged out of us, effectively, but that's okay. other living systems emerge out of other living systems. That seems to have happened in the biological case in the, during the history of life on Earth. And so the rather radical idea, and I'll put it, yeah, I'll put it out there because why not? We're supposed to have radical ideas here, right? Is that we're actually in the midst of the second genesis event, the second origin event on Earth. First happened maybe 4 billion years ago with the emergence of molecular structures that gave way to biological life as we know it. But right now there's this other thing emerging, which is entirely symbiotic with us, entirely dependent on us, but we're also entirely dependent on it, the dataome. And I feel that for an astrobiological topic, this is interesting because we're always talking about what would life be like out in the universe, how would we spot alternate life. Well, perhaps there is alternate life right here already. It's in your pocket, in your iPhone, your Android phone. It's in the structures in this building, the light, the projector, the computers, and so on. We just haven't quite recognized it as such. I'll stop there.
Thank you. And so I guess that puts us in a good position to switch over to Dario, because if you talk about encoded information, it seems that a lot of your work surrounds meaningful expression, and I wonder if you could kind of, as the artist on panel, give us a little bit about the objects that you produce as a sort of representation of being alive.
Being alive. Well, see if I could piggyback on Caleb a little bit. I'm going to answer by also asking a question. In this formulation of the datome.
It's an awkward word.
Yes.
My literary agent said, really? You're going to call it that? I couldn't come up with anything else.
Okay. We'll hammer it home. Datome. But in that formulation of how you're describing it, I swear I'm going to circle back to my work,
which I should say is being displayed prominently on the screen above us, by the way.
Yes. Where does the step of intentional meaning making come into play with when the chair fits a lot of criteria, but I can't imagine the chair intentionally seeking out meaning itself or creating it in something else. I say that obviously as an artist this is sort of what I'm worried about every day. And I like to frame what I do. I love the response in a second, but I love to frame what I do in a SETI sensibility, and I like to say that actually the problem of SETI is a really interesting problem for an artist to tackle, because I often say that, you know, what do I do every day? I wake up, I make signs and symbols, I try to invest them with meaning, and I send them out into a world with zero guarantee anyone will notice, let alone interpret them properly. And there's this basic step along the way that I find so fascinating with SETI search of looking for something similar. But it's that end point of intentionality, of expressing meaning, whatever that might be, that I, you know, can go deeper down into my work. But maybe if there's something that's popping out in your mind from my question.
Well, yeah, so I don't think the chair, I'm staring at you, chair, in the front corner here, has sort of intentionality by itself, but I would say that it is a piece of a much larger organism. Okay. It's a tiny little structure within something much grander. So the grander nature of that thing is somewhat obscured because of its complexity, but I would consider a chair as a piece of the datome. And its precise function and role within the datome, that's something to be figured out. So it's not trying to say that chair is living in the sense that we are, but that chair is part of something much more complex and much bigger that may well have the same attributes as living systems as we understand them. That's a bit of a complicated answer, but we can come back to it.
Yeah, I'm excited for both of you to hear what role, if all, that the thing that I'm focusing on here about the intentional creation of meaning plays into any sort of definitions of life or not. Please, Caitlin, I don't want to take over here. But I'll stop there.
Okay. And then Sarah, obviously I have you on this panel because I think most rigorously in an immediate application, you have a lens, which is complexity, that you are applying formally and could very easily tomorrow, like, verify the presence of something alive by virtue of an object that is sufficiently complex. And I wonder if you could speak a little bit about that sort of perspective on objects and whether or not it touches upon any of this sort of meaningful encoded information, how you would sort of repitch assembly given this idea of intentional meaning versus just intrinsic complexity.
Yeah, so I think in order to answer that question, I think we have to go back to the original question of what life is. Mm-hmm. And I think you pointed out at the beginning of the discussion that there seems to be some intuition we all share that life does something different than not life, and identifying that's quite hard. And I think part of the reason that question is hard is because we think it's a binary distinction, and it's not. And if you actually want to understand the laws and regularities that describe living systems, they should, in some sense, unify the non-living world with the living world, yet describe the features that we find uniquely in life at the same time. So it's kind of a tall order. And I think I, you know, in my whole career, I've gone through a lot of different concepts like information, complexity, you know, like causation, all these words that we have kind of vague conceptions are in the right space, an ecosystem of ideas, but it's really hard to pinpoint the thing that's life and actually figure out how to measure it. And so really what it breaks down to, I think, is actually this concept of an object and how we talk about objects in physical theories. And this is where, to me, it gets most exciting and interesting, because when you think about objects we have in current theories of physics, they're elementary objects, particles, right? They have, you know, we describe point particles. We even approximate cows as spherical objects. You know, they're point masses. And they might have a few variables that describe them. But time is never an attribute of an object. And when you get to the living world, it's very clear that things are historical. They don't emerge in the universe without a history to create them, which is the information part. That there needed to be a creator for a living object. There needed to be a lineage of things that learned how to build certain things. And so far, the way we've described that is always externalizing that information and saying, oh, that information is a feature of the organism that built that object. Or it's a feature of the context, like DNA only means something inside the cell. And that's useful to an extent to pointing that meaning is important, but it doesn't help us solve the physics because it's basically making everything context dependent, and we can't build context dependent theories. They're really hard. A lot of people have tried. So basically the sort of way that we're thinking about reconceptualizing that is to say that history and time are actually physical attributes of objects. They're intrinsic features of the object. So that chair carries meaning with it in some sense because there had to be physical systems to build it that had a meaning and an intention of building a chair, but it's also a physical attribute of the chair, and the chair is an object that actually has a size and time associated with how long it is to actually build it, how much time, how much energy, how much information. And it's not a feature of me building the object. I might actually have to exist in order for that chair to come to an existence, but the information is already in the chair. And I think that is a really different conception of what objects are in the universe, that they carry their own information, their own locality. The objects tell you where they can exist, but they can only coexist with other things that have information about them that actually can cause them to come into existence. And that's sort of the foundations of the theory of life that we're building. And then that allows you to go out in the universe and actually find an object and identify that it required historical contingency, acquisition of information, things that knew how to build it. So it's evidence of knowledge.
Okay, and what's so interesting about that is that we don't have to be able to interpret whatever knowledge is encoded in that, exactly. And so in that way, it becomes quite agnostic. And even though you had made this argument for how annoying it is to always grant context to these objects that we observe.
It's annoying only if you want to formalize it.
Okay, I was going to say, because it seems
not
like,
annoying to me as a human being.
Yes,
I like
okay.
that part.
No, but it just seems to me that like every single element of what could be a living system is necessarily context dependent, but that this kind of skips right over that, which I think is quite brilliant, but it loses out on the meaning just a bit. But that's not to say that that's not up for future applications.
It implies meaning exists.
Precisely.
But you don't necessarily need to know the meaning in order to say that that object carries meaning.
Oh, understood. Completely understood. But I think the presence of the meaning there is kind of really interesting to me, and I guess a hopeful element is that maybe future applications of assembly at scale could get at something like compositional complexity in a painting as opposed to like in a molecule. I think it's, I don't know, kind of like richly potent. But I guess with that, could we go back and talk a little bit about the meaning that you intentionally put into your work that may or may not be observable to us, the interpreters of it on Mars, despite the fact that we would recognize it and flag it as interesting?
Yeah, that's a great point about you don't need to know the content to know that meaning was somehow somewhere behind its historical existence. But with the problem of objects in the universe, that, as an artist, of course, I'm always going there because I like to think of objects in the sense, probably what Caleb's getting to, that they carry with them ethical stances as well. They carry with them positions about emotions, emotional experience. I'm talking about humans, I'm assuming something like emotions probably exists out there as well. But one of the criteria I always like to focus in on with imagining, you know, some object floating through the solar system, the case, you know, with Oumuamua was fascinating to me to watch as an artist, because it was almost as if it was an art critique going on, but it wasn't stated as such. And what I mean by that is that Avi Loeb, the other scientists who were advocating for this object being an intelligently made object floating through our, from an interstellar object floating through our system, you know, they were using the language of science, speed, size, reflectivity, weight, shape, but Avi and others take it one step further to imply that those lead us to some sort of meaning that's not just formal, in the sense that the argument about Oumuamua was that it was intentionally moving at a certain location at a certain time that we would notice it. So it was fascinating to me as an artist I love when that happens, because I love art and science so much. I love when the skill sets of just like formal description sort of uncomfortably seep out of their boundary into implied intentionality. Because, you know, now by determining the reflectivity of that object, we're suddenly into a position, a potential philosophical position about the civilization that sent it, meaning they also wonder if they were alone and decided to do something about it. And just that little notion right there, which maybe is hinging on these formal things like reflectivity and location, is fascinating to me. So that maybe that unfolds better what I was trying to ask Caleb, is that can you ever know it in the way that I think we're getting to, which is intentionally made object exchange for what? I don't know, diplomacy, emotion exchange, all the other things that make life exciting and beautiful. But it's rooted in a scientific description of where it is and all these other features.
What's so interesting, as you were talking about Oumuamua, I mean, I'm somewhat biased because I was extremely skeptical of these interpretations of a tumbling interstellar asteroid. Sorry, not a spacecraft, in my opinion. But the interesting thing is, but as you were saying, right, in a sense, that object created meaning for us or for some people. It was a reflection of their interests or desires or ambitions to see it a certain way, mm-hmm. Which does speak to the extraordinary power of our interaction with objects that we perceive to not be natural. And I'm also thinking about the chair again. Sorry, these are just thoughts off the top of my head in response to your comments. You know, what if that chair is the last thing that remains of our entire civilization and it's floating out in space and it's retrieved by some species? You know, it would be really interesting to think about the extent to which you could reconstruct things about the species that built that chair, beyond just the mechanics of it and what you might learn about the anatomy of that species, but is the poetry in that chair? Is there something that expresses the hopes and dreams of a civilization that we perhaps don't see because we're so connected with the you know, making of that chair as an object, as a practical object? But there is artistry, right? I mean, you know, these chairs may not seem like the most gloriously artistic things in the universe, but they're not bad, right? They have some form, some structure, some sculptural quality. So I wonder, you know, this also makes me think about the artifacts, not just of life in general, but the artifacts of thinking life, whatever that really means. And obviously you're a generator of those artifacts.
Yeah, and I guess I'm curious in, you know, I've studied both of your work quite a bit and have learned so much from it and trying to formulate these outlines of what life is. But it's that last little bit there that I'm obviously honing in on that would maybe push the object over the edge in the category being intentional exchange of meaning, and how that is worked into an object is just fascinating to me. I'll pause there. I would love to talk about Golden Record and how I think it meets those standards in a minute, but.
Sure, yeah. I mean, before we do, and this might be a good segue, I think the thing that I'm kind of hung up on now based on the conversation as it's happened so far is this sort of compulsion to externality. And maybe that's by virtue of a limit of our memories. We have to sort of externalize all of this historical lineage and objects outside of ourselves because we can't contain it all within us. Maybe that's separate from what I initially came on the stage thinking was like a compulsion to expression. But I wonder if any of you have an idea as to why it is that there is this necessary externalization, meaningful or not, intentional or not, that life seems compelled to do in order to best survive, to best... I mean, I guess reproduction is a sort of... A continuation in time is a sort of externality as well. But I'm just... It seems in all of your work that has been described so far, this compulsion towards the externalization of something important inside. And I wonder if you guys could speak to that a little bit as a means for detecting life objects. Maybe that last part is a bit.
I actually don't understand the question.
So why do you think it is? Do you think that, do you perceive of a limit in like a contained living, like is this because of your lineage thing? Like in an individual living system, why is it that there is this compulsion to externalizing information, whether meaningfully or not?
Oh, I think it's because we think an object is an individual object and we don't realize that they never occur in isolation. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we can do a thought experiment on a chair and a chair existing in the universe as a spontaneous fluctuation or existing floating in space, but that's not actually how chairs come into existence. They're not isolated objects.
Right, and no, so in our perception.
Yeah, we have a tendency to want to think in terms of individuals a bit too much. And I think if you start thinking about things as these structures that are extended across time, it becomes very clear that everything on life that we call life on this planet is actually the same structure. It's just, you know, maybe if you want to use information, language, a system, there was some transition that happened early on our planet that generated something we call information, and that has been structuring matter across space and time on this planet ever since. But everything it's generated has been part of a common lineage. And so unless you think about that whole structure, you're not talking about life. You're talking about individual instances of that structure that are individual objects. And since we're in that structure, it's easier for us to try to pretend we can exist outside of it and talk about it from the outside. And I think that's where the externalization comes from. Is we're not actually seeing ourselves as a temporary instance of that structure.
Mm-hmm. And maybe just to add, mm-hmm. I mean, you talk about, you know, this compulsion of life to build structures. I mean, one has to be a little cautious about that because, you know, the interesting thing about life is that life changes the environment that then changes life in this never-ending loop. And so, you know, the border between life and its environment is very fuzzy, or can be very, very fuzzy. And so I think that's part of what's going on, is that life's tendrils, in the metaphorical sense, extend much beyond, very often extend much beyond the physical confines of, you know, let's say, molecular structures that we identify with an organism or something like that.
Yeah, that still seems to me some sort of like an informationally driven manipulation of matter, but I guess I might be the roadblock here in trying to distinguish like this lineage thing versus the individual living entity, which is the like artist behind the artifact as opposed to an object as related to life. So we can move on. Dario, do you want to speak a little bit about why the Golden Record influences your work? And as a result of the fact that this is a Voyager-themed conference, I think maybe that'll get us back to some larger questions about these characteristics shared or not between art and life.
Oh, I love talking about the Voyager and the Golden Record. I'm so glad, yeah, the theme of the conference is focused on it. Well, without giving me boundaries on it, because I'm going to jump everywhere, I'll say I thought of something, you know, in preparation for the panel as far as in relation to Sarab and Caleb's, you know, some and all science, but this process of categorization, sort of finding where one threshold ends and another, you know, often artists, I often do something similar. And as in my own work, but also just in my own observations of things in the world. And something that I say the strong claim, which I think that the Golden Record's the greatest work of art that art history has never accounted for, which is, raises really weird questions why that would be the case, why it hasn't been given its due in art historical analysis, and what that would bring to the table. I have my theories as to why, but part of my work as an artist is to make that argument, back it up, sort of talk about it at multiple levels, and why it does meet all this criteria that I'm kind of putting, even from the meaning down to the state of it as a chair, just as a designed object. But one thing that I was thinking of in preparation for the plan, for the conference is, you know, of the five, or let's say there's a category of objects made by humans. It's a huge number, trillions at this point, anything ever made. Then there's that other category that have now escaped Earth's orbit. Smaller number, but growing, still pretty big. Then we move out to Cassini and other objects like that. But then we're getting into the finest or the rarest category, which is, as of today, there are only five human-made objects that can have broken free of the gravitational pull of the sun. And the way I categorize them in a bit of a romantic sense is objects that have fully escaped the fate of their home system. And of all the beautiful things we can say about those five objects, all space probes, two of them are Voyagers, two of them are Pioneer, a previous probe and New Horizon probe sent to Pluto. But they're all science. Science got them there. Very proud of that, love that tradition. But here's what's quirky about all five of them too, is all five of them literally have an artwork bolted to the side of them. That's just weird. Scientific experiments don't have artworks bolted to them. It just doesn't make any sense in other contexts to do so. And if you dig into this a little more, you know, NASA doesn't have some policy that interstellar objects should necessarily come with some art. In fact, well, there are a lot of reasons why the art didn't get included on some of those objects or more varieties of art, and I can speak to that in a minute. But I find this fascinating that if you take that as a distinguishing category, objects that have escaped the fate of their home system, that something intuitive seems to kick in the logic of object making, that sort of reconciles what back on our home planet is quite contentious, which is the sciences and humanities sort of getting along in some meaningful way to create such objects or to work on experiments or whatever. So I love that at the outer edge of the solar system, we seem to have reconciled a longstanding problem of getting over the science and humanities suspicion of each other. But it was not directed in a policy sort of way, and yet it happened. And that's fascinating to me. And I think, I mean, I'm gonna pause here. I have my theories as to why I think that's happening, but I'd love to throw that out and think about it.
I like that example a lot, but it's interesting to me because I think you're talking about the boundaries of what humans have been able to accomplish, but you can also think about those boundaries as not physical boundaries, like this is how far we've traveled in space, but also the boundaries of like what have we generated in a lab as far as molecules that could be created, or what are the boundaries of our current knowledge. And I feel like most of the people I know working in those spaces have a huge blur between what is art and what is science. So it might just be that it's a very explicit example you're giving because you can point to a physical object. But I think if you look in sort of all the dimensions of where humans are doing the most creative work, there is a lack of a distinction between those two disciplines.
You would say that scientists, I love scientists, I don't mean this rudely, but you would say that scientists have a mature enough understanding of art to make that distinction or to
no,
say
I,
that
I mean, I'm just saying, art is a human defined category. Science is a human defined category. What we are doing as minds navigating the world is something different. And some of us categorize ourselves by how we were taught to categorize ourselves. But when you go through the intellectual process of trying to build something new, those boundaries don't exist because you're in a space that hasn't been defined by humans yet.
I think I'm misunderstanding your point. I think I understand it better now.
Let's just say this. Most people think I'm a scientist. If you actually ask me what I think I am, it's an artist.
Okay.
So I think there's an interesting...
Well, in my experience, you would be an anomaly for saying that. A really interesting one and an exciting statement to make because... And it's I think it's evident in your work how broad you... how open-minded you seem to be about even how you define life. You know, I love that open-mindedness and willing to be provocative about your claims that I assume come with some price as a scientist sometimes.
You can't lose your history. It's a feature of life. Just say. You can try.
Well, do you want to?
Yeah, well, I can express some reactions as you were talking. I mean, the first is, yeah, it is kind of fascinating on the various spacecraft that... the thing that scientists think of attaching to represent our species is not, you know, a data tape of, you know, my latest bit of Python code or something like that. It's something that has humanity in it. It's something that expresses the creativity in the traditional sense of the term. So that is kind of interesting, and I hadn't really thought about that before. I mean, maybe for some scientists, it's just, oh, we better tick this box and we can't really put the data tape. We'll have to put something from one of those art museums or something. But then the other thing, the quirky thought that came to me, and I'm sorry if this takes us on a slightly different tangent, but you talked about these artifacts, these few things that are heading out into interstellar space. And something I always sort of like to ponder, especially when it's a clear sky on Earth, is that when you go outside and there's a clear sky, there aren't clouds, you are reflecting quadrillions of photons of light that come from the sun. And in principle, there's an imprint of you on every sunny blue sky day sailing out into the universe forever. And somewhere there may be a civilization on another planet that you know gets its act together and builds enormous telescopes that enable them to image things with sufficient clarity that they can see you standing outside, or the stilt walker who was just walking up and down out there. And to me, that's kind of interesting that sort of unbeknownst to most of us, we are constantly transmitting artifacts into the universe. They are not material. They are composed out of electromagnetic radiation, but they're out there all the same, all the time.
I mean, if we can take that and roll with it, I was hoping that this conversation would shift towards the sort of immaterial emergent objects that come from living systems. I think ideas are one. I like this light example. I know that Dario's done work in this realm as well, but I'm wondering about kind of going back to the disentanglement of objects, of individuals, of life, how if we consider them the way that you do, which I think is a beautiful conception, then you can't really disentangle one historical element from another across the lineage. And I'm just wondering that when, you know, if you think about the kind of planetary phenomenon that life is, both impacting its niche and then being impacted by that niche and that sort of feedback, can we say that the same is possible through the expression of immaterial objects as well? Like, how much of the same work do those things do unless it's instantiated in matter? I don't know if any of you...
We just need to redefine what matter is.
Okay, explain why.
No, seriously. I mean, I think this is the biggest problem, that people think information and things can be immaterial, and they're not. They're actually... Well, let me qualify. I mean, you can't describe information in terms of elementary particles. It doesn't exist, right? But when I think about anything that we call information is actually when we're looking at objects that are deep in time. And the more abstract they look, the deeper they are, because they're actually things that you and I share if we coexist across time. And it's not the physical thing I'm holding right now, but it's that, you know, it's like, you know, the sort of, you know, like we all have a conception that we have like a physical size. So like this chair has, you know, I'm sitting on, I don't know, it's like what, 24 inches across or something. But we don't think about it as being an object that's 3.8 billion years old. And if you take that as a physical attribute of the object, then there is a lot of structure in that space. And a lot of that structure, because we are very old objects now, is what we call information.
Okay,
it's
but
time. Information is time.
No, that's fine. I follow. I guess I'm wondering about. I do want to kind of be prickly about what I understand matter to be, because I wonder. It does seem to me that ideas have actual physical consequences.
Mm-hmm.
But so like there's some sort of transference that takes place, and that's very interesting to me, and it's something I don't understand. And it seems like there is a moment when this thing is not actually a thing in the way that we consider things to be. And I'm wondering what you might have to say, all three of you, whether it's like consequential eventually, whether it's material anyway, because it's emergent from like whatever, the chemistry lab in the back of my brain. I don't know. But it seems like there are these moments when immaterial objects can emerge from material objects and then inform the creation of or manipulation of other matter. But so what's going on in the middle? And is that anything that we could be searching for as well? I don't know.
I have an example. I don't know that I'm going to answer you, but maybe I could put something else on the table to ponder this dynamic you just described, and also to circle it back to Golden Record one more time. But here's maybe of the things on the Golden Record, there's one that stands out by far to me, the most important thing on board, and what really nudges it over to art. Andrienne, the co-creator of the record, and Carl Sagan's wife, you know, they secretly fell in love while they were making that object. And, you know, up to that point, the team hadn't really discussed, well, of all the things we're going to send, what about human love? Like this thing that we created and manifest in all kinds of forms. And I would not only claim that, you know, Golden Record's the greatest work of art history hasn't accounted for, I would also argue that Anne is one of our greatest conceptual artists that art history has never accounted for, and for this reason, because with that sort of question hanging over her and the urgency of it for an object that may be the last document of our planet, she had a wild idea, decided to record her EKG and her EEG for 1 hour, thought the electrical activity of her body manifested, or their thoughts manifested as electricity in her body, recorded, and that was then compressed, put in and onto the Golden Record. But Anne revealed years later that of the thing she thought about, which is not as widely discussed, and really pushes us into a weird area about how are those things on board if they are electrical signatures of the brain and the heart only. How is thinking about Vietnam a thing in the world that's now literally embedded in the curvature of the grooves when they were grooving that record? But my point is that in the end, Anne thought about love. She thought about falling in love with Carl, that should be there. And yet it's buried in so many obstacles, the decipherment of that object. And even if an alien sort of got over those, then you get to 1 hour of the electricity of a human thinking compressed to 11 seconds, then grooved into a sheet of gold, which is not apparent that is there, that love is somehow there. And how I'll wrap up this point that I hope is illustrative of what you're getting at, is that Anne did think about love, and she thought about other things that I won't have time to get into, as far as the responsibility of telling the truth, if this is your final document of the planet. And she took it upon herself to think about some things that otherwise the team didn't put on board, for other reasons. But my point is that even something like the strange concept of a commitment to truth in the face of eternity does have a corresponding physical shift in the way that that record was grooved. A little bit of gold got shaved off as it relates to the truth, as it would have related to a lie. And that is such an insignificant amount of matter. And yet she did it. And I ponder constantly what that means for the golden record, even in the calibrations of its long-term journey, that it's going to weigh a little differently because she told the truth than if she told a lie. And how does that project on its long-term trajectory? That's a weird, I hope, interesting way to think about these problems, about how did that manifest in a physical form that then had a long-term physical ramification just in the trajectory of the golden of the Voyager itself.
I was just, I like that example a lot. I was going to go back to your original question, though, about the immaterial becoming the material, and you can think of like three sort of three cases. So electrons don't, like, they have no immaterial, like, they're just physical objects, right? And the universe doesn't require an extra memory to produce them, so they're just made easily. A rocket requires some information to make it. Humanity had conceptions of rockets hundreds of years before we built them, so they were kind of traces in the human psyche, and then gradually we developed the technology and the information to actually make that a physical object in the universe. And then there are some objects, like a perfect circle, that will never be made in the universe because no matter how much information we have, we don't have enough information to do it precisely perfectly, right? There's just an infinite amount of information if you believe in, unless you think all of physics is built on real numbers, which came up earlier. So then there's this idea that kind of computation of making a perfect circle actually requires infinite time and we just don't have it. So there's different classes of immateriality, but I would still say that circles are causal because you could imagine making a perfect circle, and you could have an artist, for example, that wanted to try to realize that ideal by making some artistic representation of a perfect circle, or, you know, we do all kinds of approximations to it. So it still manifests in the physical world. We can talk about that object, but that particular object that we're talking about will never exist exactly as we're talking about it.
It's interesting. The first image on the golden record is a circle. Which was not coincidental, I guess. I wonder if in the logic this came up in their own, that just signaling we are trying to make a circle is itself a way of displaying a type of intelligence.
It's an interesting point. It's what, I'm sorry, go ahead. You haven't, sorry.
I mean, I was mainly just going to say how beautiful I thought Dario's expression of the consequences of love in the grooves of the golden record and the slightly different distribution of matter that resulted, that remains as an imprint of our civilization. And I think that what's so interesting to me about your description of that is that it is a different but similar way of examining the world as we do in conventional science, in as much as I think about the tiny variations in the structure of objects, of organisms, as a result of particular evolutionary processes, as a result of the instantiation of information of one kind or another, which I think relates to your point about the immaterial. I don't think there is anything immaterial. It's simply a transferring from one state of matter to another, one type of matter, one quality. But the fact that, the sort of thought experiments you can play with your beautiful statement, maybe there's a consequence in the distant future of that slightly differently grooved record that was because of her love that snowballs into something for another civilization or for some, seeding process of chemistry in interstellar space as the record finally decays into its component pieces. We can't say that that isn't the case, which is rather beautiful. And it almost goes back to the first session this morning, talking about time and the influence, the directionality of time and the influence and the probabilistic nature of what unfurls in the future. Sorry, that's really just that's the worst sort of thing. It's a comment, not a question.
No, that's great. That actually, I think, ties into the sort of final observation I was going to make in light of what Sarah said with the Voyager as a sort of example. Because one thing I think that is really cool about the Voyager mission is the kind of gravity assist that was that took place. It's like it literally could not have happened at any given time. And we've been talking a lot about how time quite often doesn't factor into our conceptions of life, but it seems pretty clear that we all kind of need to rebuild that into our frames if we didn't have it already. That's really just me. But your point about this sort of like impossibility yet like the infinite amount of time we would need for the concept of a circle to reach its reality seems very much aligned with this idea of it seems that like these objects demand an occasion for their like emergence, and so there just hasn't, for instance, been enough time for that concept to become material in a way that I have come to understand it, but that doesn't make it any less real in the sort of reality of this like shared consciousness, which may or may not be like built on the material that is our system, like our combined living systems. And so I guess it seems now that I always figured that objects were sort of more necessarily a consequence of matter, but I think I've changed my mind. I think it's sort of time first, or maybe time itself is the object that we should be focusing on.
Well, I also like to argue sometimes that the golden record could also just be looked at as a clock. There's so many grapplings with time on that record. The map to the home system that sent it is all based on the rates of 14 pulsars. There was great deliberation about signaling biological time in the images. There's even a dollop of, you know, uranium-238 that's slowly decaying on it that would signal it as a passage of time. I can go on and on. It's just like one of the most complicated clocks ever made. And they were relying on material and grooved material to convey a number of things about time. In that first panel, too, I was so taken with the discussion of time. And I forget exactly how David asked the question, but so I hope this will make sense. but the thing that popped into my head was, our a species that reflects on its mortality inevitably has to consider time in this way that I don't think that panel. I don't know if the spirit of your question was also trying to get there, as far as asking a definition of time, but a biological sense of time. Watching your children grow, watching your parents die. This is an important display of our understanding of time along with those 14 pulsars grooved on the cover. And I think, you know, as an artist, I would want to communicate, we really worry about our mortality. I didn't say my theory as to why all five of those objects do have an artwork or artifacts bolted to them, but it is related to this point. I do think we could look at both all five of those probes and the art and art artifacts they carry as a type of what I would call mourning art. And mourning art is also an interesting category of objects humans have made that are invested with meaning. Things we tend to make when we were in states of trauma or grief or loss, that I often like to say that if you could put this on a table, like everything anyone's ever made in the world, in a moment of grief, there's an alternate history of materials and, in particular, aesthetic decision-making occurring that's wildly similar. I don't know, cognitively, if the chemical cocktail of being in a state of loss sort of accidentally nudges a relationship to materials and aesthetic decisions that is human-wide, because it is remarkable to see through time and cultures similar aesthetic decisions being made by non-artists, just by people in the moment of loss. And I do think of those five objects tiptoeing over into this category of mourning art, because they all kind of have similar logics too. Again, not that each team sort of consulted on it. But I'll pause. I don't want to go on too long. I'll pause if anyone wants.
No, that's okay. I did get the signal that we should wrap up and open up. But I just wanted to give all of you one last opportunity to kind of make your stake on the question of an object for life, in case anything's come up through this conversation that you really want to correct. because I think I have some reconciling to do myself, but that's my own problem. Shall we call this object complete? Yeah? No? All right. All right. Does anyone in the audience have any questions they'd like to throw at the panel?
Well, two of them are, there's replication. There are two golden records, two pioneer plaques, and a number of objects that were included on the New Horizon. And as a little interesting side note, the ashes of the scientist who discovered Pluto are on, bolted to the side of New Horizons. As far as I know, the first instance of human DNA crossing the edge of interstellar space. Also a weird thing to ponder.
Getting back to this issue of art and science and how perplexed you were, you thought they, you know, scientists couldn't grasp art and so on. I'm completely with Sarah on this. I think art and science come exactly from the same wellspring, and that is from our engagement with the natural world. And scientists want to understand it, and artists want to engage with it and interpret it and so on. And so I consider myself an artist too, Sarah. So
I don't mean to hog that conversation. Please, for especially
considering... I don't mean to come down on you. I'm just saying there is another view.
No, and I especially considering you're the one asking me, I would love to clarify. I did not... I think we got tied up in a misunderstanding of what I... thought you were defining as art as opposed to science. I've devoted much of my career to advocating for scientists feeling comfortable to let's talk about it. So I would hate that you would think that that's my philosophy when it couldn't be further from the truth. I mean, my whole argument is with the Golden Record, I hope, illustrates why I'm trying to reconcile these divisions that are unnecessary.
And just for the record, you may not be aware of it, but we put the ashes of Gene Shoemaker on a mission that went to the moon. And there's a whole story behind it, so.
Hi, I really like that point, actually, about the collaboration between art and science. As a scientist myself, I think that where those connections are made are critical for both sides. You need that interconnectedness of both art and science to really be effective at either one. But to your point about, you know, the history and sort of those overlapping concepts, I sort of have two questions. The first question is, do you think that it's possible that those who have expressed that grief in those moments express that grief in that way because there is a history of expressing grief in that way, or is it outside of that realm and completely independent? And my second question is there an ability to take what we're learning and applying not only to astrobiology but also to bioarchaeology and saying, okay, we're thinking about outer space and possible other life forms in this way, do we need to take that and reevaluate how we've evaluated history and say there's a way of saying this collective consciousness as a series of objects versus looking at an artifact as an artifact? We are applying meaning to it, but should we be looking at it in the greater sense of civilization, which I think archaeology does, but is there sort of those connections being made there?
I have things to say, but I should let somebody else speak here.
I'm still gathering thoughts.
I think the place where it becomes more, I haven't really thought about reinterpreting the past, although there are some things like a lot of people in my field in origins of life think that the origin of life happened in some warm little pond or something. It was like a local event on a planet. And there's other ways of thinking about the emergence of life as a planetary scale phenomena and a multi-scale phenomena. And I think that's a much more interesting way of thinking about that problem, because you automatically get the kinds of hierarchies and scales of organization that we think are deeply intrinsic to life when you think about the origin life process across those scales. But we're, so there are ways of reinterpreting the way we think about the past that way, but I think where it also becomes important is to try to understand ourselves in the context of the technosphere and like the long-term future, because obviously we have this sort of existential crisis that we're building these systems that maybe are more intelligent than ourselves, and we're now like, you know, the single cells in a multicellular organism or something. And so understanding, I think, life in terms of this kind of progression across time and thinking about what are the analogies from the history of the progression of life on Earth that apply to how we can understand what's happening now and what will happen in the long-term future is really relevant in thinking about sort of collective intelligence across scales and those kind of things. So, so I think for me, where I see more power in is actually thinking about thinking forward rather than backwards. They're both useful though. It's a good question.
Maybe I could add a quick point about the first question. In my, you know, training and interest about the history of aesthetics that aren't exactly aligned with official art history, I would say that in my experience, like with the category of morning art, there are other categories, something called trench art that fascinates me, across time and culture, without any prompting, and in my experience, without any knowledge of a lineage, of historical lineage, that over and over, soldiers in a time of war will take shrapnel, carve a bullet, try to find some organization or beauty in the literal material of the war, of war, or war made in POW camps. These are people who are thrust into a situation from all over the world, ethnicities, ages, intelligence, that. That's what's so fascinating about it to me, is that without any prompting, a situation in life demands an aesthetic response as core as eating or breathing, that it's that's necessary as a fundamental feature of who we are to try to craft that meaning. So in my experience, there are a lot of examples of what I would call aesthetic traditions that don't have any, that the people displaying them have no knowledge of the lineage of it before. And what I don't, you know, I find that fascinating, because I wonder if it's sort of nudging at something cognitive about humans that in the relationship to materials and aesthetics that only arise under such traumatic situations. And it doesn't seem to be historically grounded in the way I think you're asking.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question.
Hi. So I have a question about like the way we interpret objects when we're looking at them out of context. Like, I think about like having an art history teacher that was talking about the Venus and Willendorf, and everyone thinks it's like this fertility object and adds all this meaning and like cultural significance to it, but that they made the point of like it could have just been a toy. Like, and thinking about how sometimes the way that we're interpreting objects that we find is very much based on our own experience, which I think is like the whole kind of impetus for this panel to begin with. But I'm curious if you guys have examples of, I guess, things in which you have seen someone either interpret something or like signify a meaning on something that is actually very different than maybe what everyone else thought, or like a change in perception, like when you're a scientist or an artist looking at an object or a problem, like techniques that make kind of pull you out of what I think your stance is to be able to like reframe your perception of that object. I mean, you think about like an alien looking at like a decaying uranium or something, like it would take a lot for them to be able to reframe their relationship with uranium to be able to understand that it's a time-based object maybe. And just wondering if you guys have any thought about how people use methods to reframe their relationship with that object that is outside of the system that they maybe would normally understand it.
I mean, it feels like you're speaking to what I think is one of the central challenges of science, is to cut away some of your instinctive preconceptions about the meaning of things placed in front of you. Yeah, I mean, the example you gave is a good one, but I think throughout science, we're constantly looking at things and, we don't always do a very good job at sort of self-analysis. Why do I think Oumuamua is an alien spaceship and not just a chunk of nitrogen ice rolling around in the cosmos? And, that's kind of an extreme example. And to be fair, it was kind of a deliberate decision on the part of some people to make that interpretation as a provocation. But I'm sure there are specific examples, but what you're saying rings true to me just as a generic quality of doing science is you always look at stuff and you try to fit it into your current paradigm, and that paradigm has history, and that may be completely the wrong thing to do if you really want to understand it. So I think it's this is a weaselly answer to a good question that I think a lot of people in science certainly are very aware of that potential bias. The trouble is it's the unknown unknowns. So if it isn't this, what is it? And that's, to me, one of the beautiful and interesting things in science is when those jumps of conception take place.
Just a quick point on this. I find the most interesting intellectual exercises are to take the things that people think are facts or core assumptions and realize you can rearrange them slightly and still maintain logical consistency, but it opens up a new domain space for thinking about those problems. And then you start to realize sort of which sets of assumptions actually don't agree with one another, don't work well in sort of a new... So there's ways of playing games with the way that we think about things by trying to look for consistent narratives that describe the same things but are not the current narrative.
I'll only quickly add, we're kind of in the middle of a broad cultural experiment on your very question, of course, with our reanalysis of monuments and the historical lineage that they might or might not have got accurate or whose history they're telling. So it's actually quite fascinating. As an artist, I'm obviously keeping my eye on this, especially what we tend to do as a culture with those objects we've suddenly reinterpreted, whether they get melted down or stored in put in some basement. I have strong opinions about that kind of intervention, but we're actually in the midst of a fascinating experiment on this very point.
I just want to say one more thing, and I think it sort of rounds out with the points that are being made here. To me, interpretation is a very active, present way that one should be examining the world that they are occupying and moving through. And so, this idea of reinterpreting or just reapplying an interpretation that has worked once in the past seems like kind of really short-sighted. And I think that the brilliant among us have the capacity to literally interpret at every moment logically what we might be observing. And in that way, I think new narratives could emerge, or at least new perspectives that would then demand new interpretations as opposed to reinterpretation.
Sorry to follow that up. As I was thinking about the previous question, what you just said, I mean, the fascinating thing is, why we have paradigms. And at some level, it's because it provides a predictive power, right? And this goes back to fundamental things about the nature of life. Life is something that can often make predictions about what to do next that are favored favor survival of a living system. And those things are reinforced, we think, through processes of selection, right? And so, those processes of selection take place within something like science as well, interrogation of the natural world. But evolution doesn't know what it's doing. Evolution is a blind thing. And so it's only in retrospect that you can say, that selective force was there because it encouraged the continuation of that particular lineage. So I think there's quite a bit of that beneath all of this as well. It's not just a quirk of social convention or the convention of science as a mental discipline.
Yeah. Okay, can we get a round of applause for our panelists? Thank you all. I should mention Caleb is actually signing copies of his book outside in the press tent, and I would encourage you all to grab it. It's fabulous. Additionally, Chris Kempes is giving a related keynote lecture in like 5 minutes about how to find life anywhere in the universe, the universal laws. We'll see what those turn out to be. But thank you all.